And this is the Access Equip, a winsome witness who hopefully give you some practical motivation and tools for sharing your faith with other people, sharing the gospel with other people. We want to start with a video from, and I always forget, Jeremy, is it Penn or Teller?
Penn and Teller. This is Penn.
This is Penn, mm-hmm. right, discussing an encounter he had with a believer.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, and he's, you know, he's a proclaiming atheist. And this was a video of him describing an event that took place after one of his shows, one of his magic, you know, comedian type of shows. And we, I believe on the live stream, we're going to have the audio for us here in house. We'll have the video and audio. But sit back and listen to this for 5 minutes, and then we'll briefly discuss some implications and jump into better discussion, deeper discussion on evangelism. So let's roll that video if we can.
All right.
I want to talk to you about this. I get home from the show, and at the end of the show, as I've mentioned before, we go out and we talk to folks and, you know, sign the occasional autograph and shake hands and so on. And there was one guy waiting over to the side in the what I call the hover position after I was all done. Big guy, probably about my age. Big guy. And he had been the guy who has picks the joke during our psychic comedian section of the show. So he had the props from that in his hand because we give those away. He had the joke book and the envelope and the paper and stuff. If you haven't seen the live show, it's not worth explaining. But he had props from the show that we'd given him from the night before. He wasn't the guy that night. And he walked over to me and he said, I was here last night at the show, and I saw the show and I liked it. And he was very complimentary about my use of language and complimentary about, you know, honesty and stuff. He said nice stuff. No reason to go into it. He said nice stuff. And then he said, I bought this for you. And he handed me a Gideon Pocket Edition. I thought it said from the New Testament, but I also thought it was Psalms from the New Testament, right? Psalms from the New, just part of the New Testament. Little book about this big, this thick, you know. He said, I wrote in the front of it, and I wanted you to have this. I'm kind of proselytizing. And then he said, I'm a businessman. I'm sane, I'm not crazy. And he looked me right in the eye and did all of this. And it was really wonderful. I believe he knew that I was an atheist. But he was not defensive. And he looked me right in the eyes. And he was truly complimentary. It wasn't in any way, it didn't seem like empty flattery. He was really kind and nice and sane and looked me in the eyes and talked to me and then gave me this Bible. And I've always said, you know, that I don't respect people who don't proselytize. I don't respect that at all. If you believe that there's a heaven and hell and people could be going to hell or not getting eternal life or whatever, and you think that, well, it's not really worth telling them this because it would make it socially awkward. And atheists who think that people shouldn't proselytize, just leave me alone, keep your religion to yourself. How much do you have to hate somebody to not proselytize? How much do you have to hate somebody to believe that everlasting life is possible and not tell them that? I mean, if I believed, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that a truck was coming at you and you didn't believe it, that truck was bearing down on you, there's a certain point where I tackle you. And this is more important than that. And I've always thought that, and I've written about that, and I've thought of it conceptually. But this guy was a really good guy. He was polite and honest and sane, and he cared enough about me to proselytize and give me a Bible, which had written in it a little note to me, not very personal, but just, you know, liked your show and so on. And then like five phone numbers for him and an email address if I wanted to get in touch. Now, I know there's no God, and one polite person living his life right doesn't change that. But I'll tell you, he was a very, very, very good man. And that's really important. And with that kind of goodness, it's okay to have that deep of a disagreement. I still think that religion does a lot of bad stuff, but man, that was a good man who gave you that book. That's all I wanted to say.
That's pretty powerful, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's pretty wild. Am I on? We good? Let's pray, and then let's briefly discuss the implications of that video. Father, bless this time, Lord, of learning, of applying, absorbing, discerning. Spirit, just be with us in this moment, in this time, and make this seminar, this session, exactly what it needs to be for all those who will hear it today. In the house, as well as live streaming, and then later on via podcast, Lord. Use this to save many, to bring many into your kingdom. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, for sake of our at-home audience, I will, Tim or I will repeat what you say, but what are the implications, just quickly, briefly, of some, what did you take note of in regards to how that applies to you or anyone when they share their faith, or when others absorb someone's information as they share their faith?
I think it can be easy to, I don't want to say fake it, but you mentioned multiple times about how genuine the guy was. And that's not something you can really fake.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which I think for a lot of times this work starts, and I think evangelizing is the outpouring of what's going on between you and the Lord. So, but was feeling touch on it, obviously, but I think that's where a lot of, you know, stuff like that comes from.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't think it should be something you have to force or, you know, have to feel like it's a chore.
Right.
Yeah.
It should just come natural, I think.
So the sincerity, the genuine nature of the Christian sharing with Penn.
Yeah, and that it wasn't forced.
Wasn't forced, and it was from the overflow of that guy's connection with the Lord and feeding off of that passion. Yeah. What else sticks out? Yeah.
I kind of struggled with, like, what I was supposed to say and something like that.
Mm-hmm.
I was talking about journaling. He always talked about zeal without knowledge is destructive.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I feel like right now I got a whole bunch of zeal.
Mm-hmm.
Really, very much knowledge. So at the same time, like, I don't try to say too much because, like, I don't want to lead nobody astray. But, like, I just try to kind of, like, explain my experience and what's going on in my life.
Yeah. Yeah, so Darius, rephrasing that is, what resonated with you was his comment of how much you have to hate somebody to not share, right? And then the your the tension that you feel in regards of sharing with others, but yet you don't know how much to share and what way to share because you don't want to like mess something up. Knowledge without zeal, as you say, you know, Jordan has impacted you with that quote. And Jordan, by the way, is a brother who loved Darius enough to speak the truth to you and share the gospel, and you became a Christian because he did care enough to throw you out of the way of that truck that was coming, you know. And but a simple, real quick portion of scripture that comes to mind in regards to having to have it all figured out before you share your faith, not wanting to mess it up, is the fellow that was born blind was healed by Jesus, and they're asking him questions. And he's like, look, I don't know. There's so much I don't know, but one thing I do know, I was blind and I see. And so, you know, we can share the story of what God's done for us, like to your point of that connection with Jesus personally. We can share our story. You don't have to have it all figured out, you know. No one has it all figured out, right? What else sticks out?
Yeah. Well, it's something that you said, too, stuck out to me when you said it, was about I probably want it for them more than they want it for themselves. And I would say then they're consciously aware that they want it for themselves, you know. And so that's an interesting way to put that. But because we know the truth of it, that they are about to be hit by the truck, and they might not even be aware of that, you know. So we want them to not have that consequence.
Yeah, and the sincerity piece that kind of ties these two together is people can discern when you want it as much for them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And versus you just trying to check off a list that you've told somebody.
Right. Yeah, people don't want to be your project.
Yeah.
They want to be your friend. Right. Yeah,
so anyway, this video has made a significant impact on me. I've watched it so many times over the years. It's probably, I don't know, 7 or 8 years old. I just thought it was a good place for us to start. And then, Tim, won't you take over here on the topic of evangelism, sort of discussing the nature of it and whose job is it to share and so forth?
So to kind of give a definition of it first, basically just the word evangel or whatever means just to tell the good news, right? So just, and specifically the good news of what Jesus has done, what God has done for us through Christ. And that's a humongous topic, right? Because one of the things that I have become more and more and more aware of is that's something that I need every day, right? As I, you know, what am I now, 40 years down the road almost of walking with Christ, but I still need it every day. And so I need that good news said to me all the time. Today we want to focus specifically on telling the good news to somebody who has not yet become a believer, right? And so that's where we want to focus today. One of the things that we can is, I think it's American Christians or Western Christians, maybe, I'm not sure exactly how to categorize it, but we can get into the mindset that the sharing the gospel with people or leading people to the Lord is something that the pastors do, the professionals do, the elders, the church workers do. So that's something that Jeremy's supposed to do, but not something that I'm supposed to do, right? To me, the best term that I have to name the group of people that are supposed to be sharing the gospel and bringing people to the Lord is just folks, just the folks that believe it are supposed to be telling it. In Matthew 9, Jesus talks about that. He looks out and he sees all the people that are, you know, just struggling with life. And he says that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few, right? And he doesn't say the managers are few, or he doesn't say the property owners are few. He says the laborers are few. It's just the folks out there that just need to do the work. And then there's the parable of the sower in Matthew 13. So the harvest is plentiful is right at the end of Matthew 9. In Matthew 13, kind of off and on through the whole chapter of Matthew, 13th chapter of Matthew, Jesus talks around the parable of the sower. And I think for us, there's all kinds of things going on, and there are all sorts of neat insights. But in terms of evangelism, it's just the sower was sowing the word, just putting the word out, and not feeling responsible for what happened with the word, but just getting the word out, right? So God is the one that prepares the soil, that makes the growth, that causes the circumstances to be right. And we'll talk, we'll kind of key into how to get aligned with that a little bit later on. But our job is to just sow, right? So, and under the direction of the Lord. One of the things that I thought about as I was looking over this is that when Jesus issued the Great Commission, we look back and see those 11 guys that were in the room when he issued the Great Commission. Well, they weren't, I guess it was after the resurrection. He said, you know, go make disciples of all the nations. He told the disciples to make disciples. Well, we look back, you know, these are the great guys that are, you know, martyrs and heroes of the faith, and there's churches named after them and all this kind of stuff. But at that moment, right, they're just folks, right? There's, you know, some fishermen, there was a former tax collector, there was a political activist, you know, just some guys, right? And there was nothing special about them at that moment. They became special because they took Jesus' words to heart and actually obeyed them. But the plan was for them to make disciples, and if they're disciples and making disciples, then it would seem that part of the definition of being a disciple is to be making disciples, right? And so one part of that is the idea of being involved in evangelism and letting people know what it means to be a believer. I want to flip back over to Jeremy now and kind of give sort of like a broad brush stroke. Of the overall story, and then we'll kind of get into some, take a break, and then we'll get into some particulars. So.
Yeah. Thank you, Tim. So when I think of evangelism, we're trying to share the good news of what God has done for us through Jesus in a conversation. And, you know, when you consider the Bible and the 66 books, the 40-plus authors, the many different genres, it can be overwhelming to think, how do I take all of this and reduce it to a conversation with Dean? Like, how do I break this down in this way to where Kimberly would understand it? And what do I leave out? What do I insert? Like, what's essential when you think about how to share the good news, right? And so when I think about, like, the conversation itself, part of my thought is, how do I reduce this, right? And so I can reduce it, and you've probably heard this with us, if you've been with us any length of time here at the Axis, to the grand narrative, because it takes this big book and reduces it to the meta-narrative of Scripture, the one big story of Scripture, and it reduces it down to four terms, which is creation, fall, redemption, recreation. And so I use that flow when I talk to people about Jesus is, man, like, everything was once really good, creation. Everything was beautiful. God said it was good. Man knew that it was good. It was wonderful. Everything was perfect. No briars, no thorns, no ticks as we know them, no mosquitoes as we know them, no poison ivy as we know it. Everything was great. Everything was wonderful, right? No frustration, no need for sanctification. Everything was perfect, right? Creation. And then, of course, the fall, which is step two of the grand narrative, phase two, is when mankind was deceived by the deceiver, Satan himself, to not trust God, to question whether his intentions are good, whether he's telling all of the truth, and whether we should act independent of being obedient to him, right? So man, Adam and Eve, chose to do their own thing in their own way rather than God's thing in God's way. They didn't trust him. They said he couldn't be trusted, and they chose to do their own thing. As a result, sin came into the world, the first act of rebellion, of taking the fruit that God said, don't take. And if you think about it, in the garden, everything was unlimited yeses. Everything. Everything was a yes. You ask God for anything, it was a yes. There was only one commandment. There was only one no. Don't touch that tree. And we were deceived into taking that tree, thinking we knew better than God, which is at the heart of sin. And then after that, of course, Adam and Eve run. They try to compensate with this loss, with this guilt of trying to cover their shame and their sin. And then God takes initiative to move towards Adam and Eve, even in the garden, makes coverings. And then, of course, all throughout the Old Testament of the sacrificial system and the commandments and what to do when you break the commandments. And all this was foreshadowing the cross. Okay, So creation, fall, and then that redemption piece. Here's the wheelhouse. Well, let me get through this real quick. Okay, so redemption is the work of Christ on our behalf. It is the grace of God for us. It is God taking the initiative to bring us back to himself. And this is where the fourth point comes about. The result of that redemption is the recreation, the new creation, the new kingdom, where we are reconciled and united back into friendship and relationship with God, culminating one day into an eternal kingdom that is already in some ways going on right now but will one day be experienced by all Christians, all tongue, tribes, peoples, and nations who belong to God, will be celebrating forever and ever and ever without sin. It'll be just like creation, except bigger and better. What started in a garden is going to end up in a celestial, heavenly city of paradise, and it's going to be amazing. It's going to be fantastic, right? Words can't describe how wonderful it's going to be. Now, that's the big story. I wanted to go back to that wheelhouse, and here's where evangelism, this is the heartbeat, the core of evangelism, is that redemption piece, okay? Within that redemption piece, I want you to answer some questions, and you can write about this later on, you can journal about this later, but when you think redemption, think Jesus. Jesus. And then you can answer these questions, each of these, I think it's six questions. Jesus, who he was, who he is, who he will be, what he has done, what he is doing, and what he will do. Evangelism essentially is telling people the answer to those six questions. Who he is, who he was, who he is, who he will be, what he's done, what is he doing, and what will he do. Learning the answer personally of how to articulate those answers in your own language and through your own experience from Scripture, speaking that wonderful news to others and inviting them into that new creation where all things can become new, where you can be reconciled back to your Creator. You can be forgiven of your sin, redeemed of your guilt and shame, and live free today and forever. Right? So creation, fall, redemption, recreation. Redemption, think Jesus. What he did, what he's doing, what he will do, who he was, who he is, who he will be. And so that's just, in my mind, trying to reduce such a big story, such a big, big book made up of 66 books into one conversation. And you could probably boil it down to even a 5 to 8 minute conversation, even with questions as you work things out with your friend. But I encourage you to answer those six questions and to articulate more personally your understanding of that redemption aspect. I believe that's it. Do you want to step back in here? You want to take a... Okay, let's press onward. Yeah. Here we go.
Yeah, we had planned to take a break because we thought this would take longer than it did, but y'all just kind of got set down and settled, so we'll go on a little further, and I've got to unlock my computer, so I'll know what it is I'm supposed to be talking about. Do what? Yeah. So, and Zach kind of touched on this, and we kind of saw it in the video or the audio for you folks online that were the Penn and Teller, the Penn discussion there about having that encounter with the believer, was that the genuineness of that guy's conversation with Penn, and that we don't want people to be projects. So the overall kind of umbrella for everything we're going to talk about, specific tools and techniques and stuff, we want to make sure, I want to clearly say that this needs to occur within a relationship. That there was a time 70 years ago, 80 years ago, maybe as recent as 30 or 40 years ago, where you could go down to Second and Broad and stand up and start talking about Jesus, and there would be people there that would respond to that, right? But that time is pretty well over now. Maybe once or twice out of 1,000 people, something like that will happen. But people come to know Jesus because they're in a relationship with somebody that already knows Jesus. You know, Jordan and Darius being a wonderful example. Me, I knew the story, but it was the people that I was around that I saw something different in, right, that made the difference. And so The gospel clearly flows easiest and it's most natural if you already have a relationship with somebody because you already know how to have a conversation with them, right? You've already talked about stuff. You probably already talked about things that are challenging. They like the Chiefs and you like the Bucks, right? So that's a challenging conversation, right? Or you know, whatever it could be. Bring up whatever the most least controversial topic you can think of if you've had those discussions, right? So you already know how to have those kinds of discussions. And so if we want to be doing evangelism, that means then we need to be in relationships with people that are not yet believers, right? And so it's with a great church like we have here, it's easy to get what we would call a holy huddle, where everybody that we know, everybody that we do things with, everybody that we're around is already a believer. Well, I mean, you can't do evangelism with people that are already there, right? So, if you don't currently have, or if I don't currently have relationships with people that are not believers, not yet believers, then start to think about that. Where are some ways I could begin to have invest in some people and get to know some people? That one of the books we're going to give as a reference is the gospel comes with a house key, right? That's the name of it, right? And the premise of that is this lady just started inviting people from the neighborhood into her house, and that was the premise, right? It was not because she wanted to do so-and-so and so-and-so, or because this was going to happen, or they wanted to talk about this. It was just, she just started inviting people into her house, right, and building relationships. And then out of those relationships, then there was opportunities to share the gospel and invite people to Christ. You trust people more that you have a relationship with. You've had an opportunity to see, genuineness in them or sincerity in them. Hopefully, you don't make projects out of the people that you're in relationships with. That sort of stuff. Some suggestions, if to get outside your church community, if you have them, is people at work. If you have some hobbies or interests, there's like a hiking club in Nashville that they've got a Facebook group, and they'll post up there, hey, we're going to, Burgess Falls Saturday. Anybody that wants to come, come, right? Or there's, all sorts of interest clubs like that you could get into, that sort of stuff. Or I have a friend of mine who has a little dog, right? I make fun of him because he has a little dog, right? It's his wife's dog. But he gets to walk the dog every morning, right? And as he walks the dog through his neighborhood, he just stops and talks to people. And I don't know the number, but it's double-digit numbers of people he's led to Christ just taking the dog for a walk. Right? The relationships that grew out of that, right? So just being open to those opportunities, right? So that's going to be kind of like the overarching umbrella that we think all of this needs to happen, not what we might call cold turkey evangelism, where you're just gonna, grab somebody at the airport, and do the tools, the techniques that we're gonna talk about here. So that's not what we want to do. Within that, and coming from that basic framework, one of the huge priorities that we have has to be the idea of prayer. Okay? That if we're not praying for people to come to know Christ, then it's in our own strength, right? And also, not only is it in our own strength, but also we're not going to be connecting with God to get connected with the people that He's working with to bring to Himself, right? And so there's a two facets to being in prayer for people, two major facets. And one is to get myself attuned to what I need to be doing, right, and how I need to be doing it, and the approaches I need to take, and the relationships I need to build. And the other is getting me into the place where God is also working, right? And again, the third would be also through prayer, getting God to work. And don't want to make that like I'm manipulating God, but it does. That happens. When we start praying for people, God starts to work, right? Or maybe we just start to recognize that He's already been working, and we just start to see it. So that is probably the best tool for personal evangelism, is to start praying for people, right? Because that invokes God's power way more than our trying to do something out of our own strength. So please don't, I guess to say this as a warning, please don't use any of these techniques and tools we're going to give without being in prayer about this first. So Jeremy and I have two different terms for it. Jeremy used the term God's top 10 most wanted list, right, which I thought was a cool term. Mine was a little more formal term called an evangelism prayer list, or EPL for those of us that love TLAs, or three-letter abbreviations, which my son would enjoy that, right? So, your TLA is a three-letter abbreviation, right? So evangelism prayer list. And so let me challenge you to do this, and we'll tackle a couple more things before we take a break. But think about who are the not yet believers in your circle of friends, right, that God's given you a concern for. Okay, so who are the not yet believers in your circles that God's given you a concern for? And I would suspect that you're here today, if you're listening to this online, that people came to mind, right? If nobody came to mind right away, then the first prayer would be, God, give me a heart, give me a concern for these people that are about to get hit by a truck, right? Give me that, what Penn said, you know, if shouldn't I be doing this if I really believe that there's eternal consequences for this, right? So think about those folks and write them down on a list, right? You know, put them on a list. Jeremy?
Yeah, a thought on that is also, you know, taking your top 10, if there's 10, come up with 10, and even adding a calendar event for a certain time of day every Monday to pray for that guy. Every Tuesday, a calendar event that pops up to pray for this girl every Wednesday, and then do two on Saturday and two on Sunday, and then one extra one throughout the week on a weeknight, you know, and just set these calendar reminders so you're getting pinged twice a day on 3 days, and then the other days just once a day at different times, you know.
Or, you know, stick a post-it note on your dashboard or for those of you that are in your cars, I'm in my car like once a week now. So, I don't know if this is really on target, but I filled up my car the middle of March last year and did not put gas in it again until like the end of June, right? So it was crazy, like what the heck, right? But so all that stuff that I would do in my car, you know, it just stopped happening, right? But yeah, so find a regular time to, you know, like reminders like that, reminders around the house, post-it notes or something like that. And just start to pray. Just start to pray for those people. It can, you know, it doesn't have to be, if you don't know what to pray, you know, just pray for God to work in you and in them, right? And then as you, if you're in relationships with them, then you would, there could be specific things, right? So the folks on mine, there's some specific things I know about them, but there's other things that, you know, just it's more general, vague prayers and stuff like that. Not vague, but more general things that could, that even if we don't know the specifics, as we're in relationships with the people, we'll start to notice, right? There's some things that, oh, that's related to what I was just praying about 3 days ago, right? And so you see God starting to connect, or you will, I think, see God start to connect your thinking with their circumstance and their thinking and talking with what you have, what God's given you in your heart and stuff like that. So, again, within the context of relationships, think about those people that are not yet believers that God's given you a concern for, right? And, again, that could be people that you work with, people that you play with. That could be family members, right, which is usually the hardest people to do evangelism with, right? The ones we have, you know, the closest relationships with, and they can tell the best if we're being genuine or not genuine, those sorts of things, right? So family members, coworkers, co-players, people in, you know, on game nights, you know, whatever it might be. If you're taking classes, like an online class or, you know, just a hobbyist class or something like that, maybe people in the classes, those sorts of things, right? And then as you move in that, so if you're praying for people, one of the things that is typically going to happen is, again, you will start to connect. You'll start to see things in their life that God's pointing out to you that, oh, this is where they're starting to struggle, or this is where you have something you can speak to. Or they will start to see things in your life that maybe is different. I've been challenged in the past couple of years, a couple of different verses that really struck me just recently, within the past week or so. I was looking with a friend of mine. We were studying. We're working our way through Acts pretty slowly, and in Acts 14, right at the beginning, Paul is given a message to some believers, and there's a lame man, a crippled man. In the audience, in the congregation, whatever the term is to use, and Paul looks at the man, and the Acts 14:9 says, Paul could tell from his face the faith that he had faith to be made well. Right. And so what struck me particularly about that is that you could see something in that guy that was different. Right. Paul recognized there was something in that man that was different than the other people he was looking at. Right. And then in 1 Peter 3:15, Peter encourages us to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you to anyone who asks you. It says do it with gentleness and reverence, kind of back to our discussion about the video. But to make a defense to anybody that would ask you. And what struck me about that, somebody pointed out to me about that, I know about being ready to make a defense, that's something I can do, but to anybody that asks you means that there's something different about me that somebody sees, right? And so I think as we pray for people, as we put this on our front burner, so to speak, then we will be wearing our faith in such a way that there is a difference between us and the not yet believers around us, right? The non-believers around us, that we'll respond differently, that we will react differently, we will approach things differently, and people will notice that. Backing up again to last March, I teach at Volunteer State Community College, and we took the week after spring break, didn't bring the students in or anything, and we just took that week to plan what the heck are we going to do with the pandemic and the quarantines and stuff like that. And it was crazy. It was, you know, stressful and all this stuff. And I'm walking down the hall, and one of my colleagues was just behind my shoulder. We just kind of walked out of our offices kind of at the same time, headed toward the copy or whatever it was. And she said to me, you're handling this pretty well. What's different? You know, and I kind of gave some lame response, you know, partly it's my personality, but it's a lot of Jesus too, you know, and just left it at that. I don't know what went on with that conversation. I haven't seen her in 11 months since that time, but except on Zoom meetings, but, don't know if that made a difference or not, but there was something different about how I was responding to that people noticed, right? At least one person noticed, and not to toot my own horn about that, but that's something, one time I've seen a difference, right, that we should be different, we are different, and people should see that we're different. So one of the things I want to throw out here for discussion is the idea that, okay, so as we're praying for people, or just, you know, maybe just in relationships, maybe a recognition, hey, this is somebody that I should be praying for, is what I've heard called red flag questions, right? It's basically from the sales area, and my wife's sales used to sell real actively, but sells Pampered Chef, right? And it's, while it's not fully solely multi-level marketing, there's an aspect of multi-level marketing to that, right? And so it's speaking for her, there were certain things that they were told or taught to watch for, that if somebody asked something like, hey, is that stuff heavy, is it hard to carry it back and forth from the car, that meant that they had the thought of like, well, if I was selling that, I'd have to carry it back and forth to the car every day, right? So they've had the thought of, hey, I could maybe do this, and they're thinking through some of the obstacles in front of that, right? So taking that and applying it to the relationships we have with the people, let's just kind of brainstorm what are some equivalent red flag questions that we might hear people ask, or statements we might hear people say that would be an indication, to use one of Jeremy's phrases, that there's been a mustard seed planted that's ready to be watered and start to grow. In other words, that there's a spiritual interest or a sign of a spiritual awakening like that. And I'll just give, let's see, just one right off the bat might be something like, man, my kids are driving me crazy. Now, on the surface, we've all said that, right? But that indicates that they're starting to think about some things. They've had some thoughts about some things relationally that they realize there's some things that aren't working, right? And that there's something better. There should be something better, right? Well, that's is potentially an opening for the gospel, right? All right. So what are some other these red flag questions that y'all might have? Yeah, definitely, statements. Yeah, I mean, that's not a question, right? Yes, yes.
When somebody says, I really need to get my life together.
I got to get my life together. Yeah. Got to get my life together. Yeah. Thought it, if I haven't said it right. Yeah. Yeah, as I was finding the papers that were piled up with other stuff on the desk this morning. Yeah. 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 What would I give up to be a Christian? Yeah. Or things around that.
If they mention Jesus or church, or I feel like church is a pretty easy one that I notice, that when they say, you know, like, why do you go to church?
Yeah. Yeah, so Drew, right?
Is it,
no, Dean. Dean. Yeah, I got two letters right. So Dean, it said that if they mention Jesus or mention the church, kind of like that. One thing, that's tough kind of in the South, because the church is not that different from the country club or from going to the baseball, you know, the ballpark or something like that, right? But yeah, it can be. It can very often be that there's a spiritual interest in there, right? And I would say that's becoming more the case in the South, and certainly the case outside the South, that if somebody starts talking about church, that's you don't just normally talk about church, right? So, and particularly about Jesus, right? So any mention of that. What are some other thoughts, other questions, statements that might indicate some interest or openness to the gospel? Why is the Bible what?
Man-made.
Why? Oh, is the Bible man-made? Yeah. So Darius said there was talking on the phone with a friend, and he asked him basically about the authenticity of the Bible, right? So if you're Jeremy, if you're keeping track of books to give out,
yeah.
You know, we got a couple of books that would address that. In some way. So any conversations about the Bible, you know, like that can be a spiritual opening, right? So, what are some others that you may have?
Well, the example you already gave about the encounter in March, the person noticing that you're handling something.
Yeah. You're handling X differently, right? Now that's a challenge to me, because, like, again, that, you know, the 1 Peter 3:15, do they see what's different about you, or am I somebody that you can see my faith, right? So I have to handle things differently than the world around us for somebody to notice that, right? But I think, again, having people that we're praying for, hopefully we will be, that will make God will make us more relatable in the process too, more equipped, more able, right? Other things that y'all might think of.
Why are you so happy?
Why are you so happy? That's good. Yeah. Why are you so happy? And I'll add to that calm, at peace.
Yeah. Even just not even as a question, I feel like people just say, you know, you're so joyful all the time, or you make things more like relaxing, like you said, peaceful, which is really funny. And I didn't think of that as an opportunity to share, but even being, my work is completely remote now. Joyful demeanor thought of that to think of, you know, that's because I know Jesus, but that's
Yeah. So Dean was saying, somebody says you're so joyful, you're so relaxed, you're so happy, or whatever, and that even in saying in Zoom meetings that comes across, which that's pretty remarkable. That's pretty cool. Yeah. And then other things with a lot of what I think of as kids is like, you know, why did you do this with your kids, or how did you handle this with your kids, kind of stuff. You know, those are openings. You know, we homeschooled our kids, and so, you know, that was not purely a religious decision, but that was certainly a huge part of it, right? So, you know, so why or how? Did you do X, you know, whatever it is, with your kids, for those of you that have kids? And then things like, it, to the extent that God's had a role in your career choices, your job choices, your you know, your Nashville choices. I mean, you know, we talk about our daughter and son were born in Nashville, so they're unicorns, right? Because, you know, they're Nashville natives, right? You know, and so everybody else has moved here. You know, nothing personal, right? But you know, why did you come to Nashville, right? You know, so is it, you know, or wherever you are, why did you pick, you know, this job, this place, stuff like that? Which, again, that can be a challenge too. Are we making those choices based on, you know, how God's leading us? I know I was challenged in college, and I think we've been faithful to this, to not choose a place based on career or job or income or something like that, but choose the place on where God could plant me and grow me, and then have the career and the job and stuff follow that. And we've tried to be faithful to that, like I've said, and just a little bit of our story. Came here to go to grad school and figured we'd be here 4 years and off somewhere else, and that was 37 years ago. So is that right? 30? Yeah, 30. Almost 37 years, 36 and a half years ago. So we're still here.
Another one that comes to mind, Tim, is when buying a car or a house, and people were like, well, man, if you don't make an offer, if you don't get this like today, we've got to get this in today, or, you know, I know you say you want to think about it for the next 24 hours before you let me know, but it could be sold by then. It's like, well, that's fine. Like, I'm not.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know if Jeremy was on, so I'll repeat it. But he said, like, if you're buying a house, buying a car, you know, the sales pitch of it, you know, it's not going to be here tomorrow. I need to move now. Well, no, I need to pray about that. I need to think about that. So just situations that allow you to be patient, situations that allow you to trust.
It's confusing to the other person.
Yeah.
You're going to miss this opportunity.
Yeah.
But in certain situations, it's okay.
Yeah. If I miss it, it wasn't the opportunity that I needed. And if it is, if it is, it'll be here tomorrow. Yeah,
so. So in all these phrases or questions, is it important to relate it not back to, like, for example, why did you pick this job, or why do you do this with your kid? Well, because, you know, at my church we do this. But is it more important to relate it back to Jesus and the gospel rather than, well, that's because my religion or my faith does this versus,
I would always bring it back. So the question was, on a question like this, why did you make this choice with your kids? Why did you make this choice for your job or whatever it may be? Somebody asked you a question that God's had an influence on your decision-making process. How would you answer that? And so I would say always relate it back to Jesus. So to Jesus, right? And not to a church or something like that, because particularly in the South, where there's still a fair amount of cultural Christianity, people hear church and go, "Well, my Aunt Jane goes to church, and so that's cool. I'm good," you know, kind of like that. But they may not have any experience with Jesus, where they can have a, that you can. in, you know, within 200 miles of where we sit, you can have an experience with church and no experience of Jesus, right? Or not a valid experience of Jesus, or a significant experience of Jesus. So always related back to Jesus. Okay, let me kind of try to steer us a different way. So most of these are questions or things that would allow us to have an opportunity to respond with something about our faith, right? I think another aspect of these red flag questions would be something that indicates in that person that they're starting to question, starting to, that, as Jeremy said, have that mustard seed in there that we can start to grow. And that was, I think this one, I got to get my life together. Right, that's not them asking anything from us, but that's them admitting to us that something's broken, right? Right. So what are some other things that you might hear people say that would indicate that they're recognizing that there's a need in their life that's not met, that Jesus could meet? I mean, these are good, right? I'm not saying these are bad, but these are more how can we share our faith with them? What are some things that would recognize that they are starting to recognize a need? Because if you're praying for people, then God's going to move, and some of them are going to start to recognize they have a need for Jesus, right? And so how do we recognize that they're recognizing that?
I think when they turn to us in a difficult situation in their life.
Yeah.
When they're in the middle of something that's rattling their name, Jesus.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you came to mind when this fell apart, right? So some difficult situation, and they want to talk to you. Yeah. Yes, Angie was saying that some friends had a tragedy hit, and they said, it's good that you're here. I'm glad that you're here. Right.
I had a friend recently who I haven't talked to in years and years, and he just called me out of the blue. Nothing was necessarily like majorly wrong or anything, but he literally just wanted to catch up and talk. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah. So Dean was saying there's an old friend just that he hadn't had contact with in a long time, called him, just getting reacquainted, but then asked around a real specific theological question, right? That obviously he wouldn't have asked that if he didn't think you had something to contribute to the answer to it, right? All right, so yeah. Yeah, yeah. So when we're, and that's Jeremy saying that, and as a pastor, you would get that more, I think, but we would also, you know, somebody says, can you pray for me for so-and-so? And again, in the South, that's a cultural thing. You know, we pray before a meal for whatever, and then, you know, somebody's sick, so pray for them. But Jeremy said, you can turn that back around and say, hey, you know, you can do this too. You know, you can have a relationship with God and be in prayer yourself. If you don't feel comfortable praying to God right now, here's how you can be comfortable with God. All right, so those are some good, just kind of challenges. Kind of think through that again. If we're praying for people on a regular basis, God's going to be at work in their lives, and God's going to make us aware of that. But oftentimes, with me, it's like, oh, you know, yesterday when John said that, that was like, he was really interested in something spiritual at that point, and just, you know, just tell him. Welcome back, everybody. So hopefully at home you got to get a cookie and coffee, because that's what happened here, I think. So and they're good. So if I'm a little, it's because I just had a chocolate chip cookie. So to kind of recap, we hit some of the things like everybody's a minister. Everybody is a minister of the gospel, right? So we're all called to be doing evangelism and other, you know, kingdom work. We talked about a prayer list, about having people that God's put on our heart to be praying for on a regular basis, and particular suggestions on that. And then we talked about red flag questions, like things that people are going to say that indicate there's a spiritual interest or a spiritual opening there. What I want to take most of the rest of the time we have here is to look at three or four-ish or so different ways or different approaches to actually sharing the gospel of justification, if you will, or the gospel of conversion with somebody. And a lot of what I'm going to say comes, well, from many different places, but one of the resources we've got is a book called The 3D Gospel, and you'll hear me talk about these things here. And so as I talk about this, I wanted to give a shout-out to Jackson Krumzik, who's, I think his parents are watching at least on this, who loaned me his magnet triangles here. And so here's a thing, right? So this is a thing. It's not exactly a pyramid, but it's kind of a thing, right? So, but if you look at it, forgetting the bottom, it's got three different sides to it, right? So these are three sides of the same thing. And if I'm looking at it, I'm coming at it from the yellow side. Y'all are coming at it from the purple side, and y'all would be coming at it from the green side, and y'all are kind of coming at it from an edge, right? But we would all be approaching this object, the same object, but just coming at it from three different sides, right? And so what we've recognized is that if you look at the cultures in the world, there's three kind of basic sort of worldviews that people come from to approach the gospel, right? And the one we have in the United States and in Western Europe, I guess maybe previously, I think is it fair to say, in the United States, is actually the minority view across the world. Right, and it would be what you call a guilt innocence or a law judgment approach to the gospel. Right? And just kind of looking at different cultures of different people groups around the world, about 1 billion people in the world, give or take, would approach from that side of this triangle, right? From whatever side that is, and that is the idea that God has a law. There is a right and a wrong, and that I, as a human, have broken that law. And in order to be back in a right relationship with God, something has to be repaired. Something there has to be a judgment, a sentence served, and a payment of the penalty for the laws that I've broken. Just like I have to pay a parking ticket, or I have to spend 10 years in jail for stealing a car, or whatever it may be, right? So that's the guilt moving to innocence gospel. I think of it as a law and justice, but guilt moving to innocence, right? So just call it the guilt innocence. Right. And with just kind of looking at people groups and stuff, about, like I said, about 1 billion of the 7.5 or so billion people in the world approach things that way. But I think, honestly, in the United States, in Western culture, as we have moved into more of a postmodern culture, that number is actually going down. I think that there's fewer and fewer people that approach life from a guilt and innocence perspective. Right? It's the easiest to share the gospel with, because it's like, you broke the law, here's how it's fixed, right? And it's real straightforward. But if you're looking at a person who follows a postmodern philosophy, which one of the underlying ideas of postmodern philosophy is that there is no authority or no right or wrong outside of my own personal choice of what that is, then how can God's law matter, right? How can there even be such a thing as God's law, right? So anyway, but we'll tackle that. The other one, another one is the fear-power approach to the gospel. And this is that there are forces out there in the world that I can't deal with. There are spiritual forces, there's circumstantial forces, there's things like that. And because of the fall, I am not connected with the ultimate power, the God of the universe, that can help me with these things I have no power over. All right. And so what the redemption, what the restoration is taking me from a situation of fear to where I'm back aligned with the ultimate power of the universe, right? To give you a real illustration of this, a dear friend of mine who I've lost contact with is from Nigeria. And several years ago, we were having a discussion around the very beginning of John chapter 1, where Jesus says, or where it says, the light has come into the world, and the light was the light of men. Talking about Jesus, that Jesus is the light of men, and the darkness cannot overcome it. And I made the comment that for me, for my very much modernist, you know, outside authority, God's raw and stuff perspective, that for me, darkness was the absence of light, right? And so that darkness was that there was no Jesus. And my friend said, oh, no. Darkness is the presence of evil. And so for me, darkness was just nothingness, but for him, it was very much a presence. He said, yes, that's where the evil spirits are, that's where the demons are, that's where the bad stuff is in the darkness. And the light having power over the darkness, that's not just being able to turn on a light so there's no more darkness in the room. That's defeating something that you can't defeat without the light. That's the fear power gospel is what he was talking about. Yeah, Dean. Yeah, so Dean is saying that working in summers with kids from First Nations at a camp, that they'll ask to shut the windows of the cabins at night so the evil spirits won't get in because they're in the dark. Right? Yeah. So yeah. And so if about 1 billion people in the world approach God from this side of the triangle, about 1.5 billion people in the world approach it from this perspective. And I would say actually, and this is something that really just struck me in the past couple of weeks, Angie and I have had multitude of conversations that one of the things that's come out for us of the pandemic is that what we had been seeing for many years is just this sort of free-floating fear that 20-somethings and 30-somethings have, that just lived their life with, has just become focused, right? That now they know what they're afraid of. I'm afraid of it maybe losing my job. I'm afraid of my parents dying from COVID. It may be whatever. But that fear is really boiled to the surface. And I would say right now that the whole world could respond to a fear and power approach to the gospel, right? Particularly if you're 25 years old and you used to work at a restaurant in downtown Nashville. Yeah. So this gets about 2.5 billion people in the world, right? So the vast majority of the people in the world deal with I'm totally blanking on the word. Yeah, shame and honor approach to the gospel. And this one actually is really tough for me to understand. I mean, I intellectually understand this, but it's hard for me to get a real grip on it personally. But I think this is also a good postmodernist approach to the gospel, because if you don't have any outside authority, then this is not going to work. If you're you know, apart from like I said, the fear that's been brought by COVID, this may not have much impact on you. But here. Everybody knows if God is making somebody spiritually aware of themselves, right, and that's part of being postmodern is you're self-aware, right, is that you know you screwed up. You know that down inside, you know that you're not what you should be, right? And what this idea is that you have been things that are shameful and brought harm to you and your family and your community, and that God restores you to a place of honor, and not only restores you to a place of honor, but restores himself to a place of honor because of the shame you brought on him by turning your back on him, right? And this, again, is the vast majority of the world traditionally operates, and I would say in the 21st century, Western culture is becoming more of a shame-honor approach to, or non-believers in Western culture are becoming more shame honor. So how would you approach this? So I'm going to give you, let's say, guilt, innocence, shame honor, and then we'll do fear power last. I'm going to give you a couple of different tools for doing a guilt innocence. Like I said, that's the most straightforward, right? It's how I understand, because I'm a modernist. I'm sorry, just an old guy, and it's just, there's an outside authority, and you got to follow it. It's just the way it goes. But That's, you know, that's just the way it goes. So there's a couple of different things. One is the four spiritual laws is an old one that I actually don't know very well, so I'm not going to use it. But if anybody was involved with Crew or Campus Crusade back in the old day, then you would know the four spiritual laws and stuff like that. The Roman road. If you want to have a fun little 3 minutes, go look up apologetics. That old, what's it? The Roman road. They've got a song where they take who is it? Bob Seger's old time rock and roll, and they talk about this. Yes. Yeah, it's sweet. It's sweet. Okay, apologetic. Yeah, the group Apologetics is a it's their Christian rock band that does they do parodies of rock songs, but their words are talking about the gospel or scripture, stuff like that. So let's see, you know, the Queen song Crazy Little Thing Called Love. There's one they do Crazy Little King Called David, I think is what it is. Yeah, so something like that, which is really fun. They have a parody of Stairway to Heaven, which is really good. All sorts of stuff like that. So they even have some Christmas songs. But
there's hidden somewhere on YouTube is you performing.
Oh yeah, what is it?
It was
Elvis Hotel. Heartbreak Hotel. Yeah. So.
But
it's Mary and Joseph not getting to stay in the hotel. So it's. Yeah, don't. Okay, now it's everywhere. So now I can't run for president. So Roman Road. Yeah, just that one thing. Yeah. Now they found out about the YouTube video. Okay, so the Roman Road. I'm going to write the verses here. I'm just going to say them real quick. So just this is sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's Romans 3:23, and then to Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And then Romans 5:8, but God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. That death in Romans 6:23 that we have as a result of the sins that are mentioned in Romans 3:23. And then from there, Romans 10, 9 through 10, that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you should be saved. For with the heart man believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the tongue he confesses, heart man believes, resulting in salvation, and with the tongue he confesses, resulting in righteousness, right? So that fixes that, right? So Christ's death, while we didn't deserve it, fixes that. And then Romans 10:13, for whoever will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Right, so no preconditions, anything like that. And then Romans 8:1, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So we have sinned, that sin has death as a consequence, and it's clear from Scripture that that's eternal death. That's not just your body's going to quit working, that you're going to die, be separated from God. But God made a way to fix that, and you're out from under that if you're in that group. That's guilt. That's guilt, innocence. Another one. So that's one way. That's the Roman road. I was trained in college, and I guess I still am being trained with Navigator ministers, if you will, stuff like that. And they use a tool called the Bridge. And several different ways. If anybody wants, just talk to me. I can give you a more detailed. We could spend a week. Spend a few hours just working through this, just how to do this, or just how to do the Roman road, or whatever. But based off of Romans 6:23, and if I was going to do just 2 hours on the bridge, I'd use a lot more verses. But just using Romans 6:23, which says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." Right. So, if we understand that when the Scripture talks about death, it really means not just that your body quits working, but there's an eternal separation between us and God that's caused by our sin, then there's a we need something that will fix that, right? That if we want to be in a relationship with God, that thing we know that's busted, if we want to repair that, how do we do that? Well, we don't. Wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so through the cross, God has made a bridge so that he can bring us to God. So Romans 5:8, right? So so he can bring us to God. Actually, that's 1 Peter 3:18, right? For Christ died for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order that he might bring us to God, right? So we don't go to God. Christ brings us to God. So, so that's the illustration I like to use, and I always have to go 3D on it. But the guy that taught me to do this, he said one of the times he shared it, one of the guys who didn't accept it said, "That's a really cool drawing. Would you mind if I, you know, put it up on my bulletin board?" So he said, "You know, make it a cool drawing." And I can't do cool drawings, but I still try. Okay. Okay, so those are a couple of things. The bridge illustration. You can go to the bridge illustration of the gospel. You can look that up and get that stuff. But that's the basic idea. The Roman road here to those, what, six verses, just kind of steps through that law and justice, or that guilt to innocence gospel of justification. Yes. Yes.
It's so important. And so whatever way you choose to learn to share, memorize the verses, or at least the references, so you can look them up while you're talking, because God speaks through his word. I mean, it's the power of the scripture. It's not my
word. Yeah, so Angie is saying that the scripture has power. The scripture claims power for itself, right? And so actually use the scriptures. Don't do what I just did and say, you know, that we're separated from God because of our sin, but Christ fixes that. Let the scripture say that, which the Roman walk does that, the Roman road does that. And like I said, this is guided in here, but I can give you, actually there's a dozen verses I can give you that basically walk through every step of this, right? And I've got one printout of it, I can email you a list of it, stuff like that. And also while I'm thinking about it, we've also got a list of different objections people might raise to things like, you know, well, what about so-and-so? You know, what about so-and-so? What about so-and-so? That they can kind of answer that. Jeremy, did you want
to? Yeah, just a quick thought on that. Just high-fiving Angie and what she said about the power of Scripture is letting people see it in your copy of Scripture, letting them not, it's great to be able to quote it and be able to recite it like that, but being able to show it to them is powerful. And I love the Romans Road. I've been, you know, Brian Cockman is a young man that I saw before my very eyes become a Christian in 1987, the first time I used the Roman Road with somebody. And a key, the technique is start just in the front of your Bible, writing Romans 3:23. And then in your copy, that's like step one. And so then you could go into your Bible and write underneath or in the margin of Romans 3:23, you could write 6:23. Yeah. And then beside 6:23, write 5:8, and then 10:9 and 10, then 10:13, right. And then 8:1. So it's just a little piece of advice. Yeah.
Yeah.
I just had this thought, like, as Jeremy was saying that we memorized the verse, and a big part in memorizing was we didn't always have access to a copy. Well, now everybody pretty much is carrying around a copy in their pocket.
Yeah. 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 So Angie was saying that if you have the verses memorized, like for scripture memory, then you don't have to depend on a copy. But with phones, most people have access to a copy most all the time.
And
right?
It is powerful for them to read.
And it is powerful for them to read. Yeah. It never happened to me personally, but I've had people talk about that they were going through these verses or you know, some of the multiple verses to explain this, and the person gets to a point and they just stop and you can just see the weight of the gospel hit them and just grab them, right? And just, you know, tears flow and it's awesome.
How long is this whole, would you say that whole thing would take?
As long as you want it to. I mean, I just spent 73 seconds on the Roman Road when I actually did it, right? Maybe, right? But I would, you know, really want to do some explaining and stuff like that. This,
10 minutes.
Yeah, 10 minutes would do. Not in 2021. Yeah. The ROI, the return on investment, is really low. If it's 1952, you're going to get, you know, a 50% return on your investment doing that kind of stuff, probably.
But in the margin of 5-8, I would also write just a great exchange if you're familiar with that.
Yeah. Jeremy says this is the great exchange. And Angie, were you going to say something?
You need to do some homework. Either, you know, we have another workshop, or say, hey, let's get together and work on this for a couple hours, or at some point need to learn and be prepared how to transition into this when the question comes. And you might just use one verse, or they might be ready to sit down and talk about the whole thing. But to me, that's what the be prepared. I mean, you need to be sensitive to the Spirit, definitely. But there is some actual work you can do to be ready.
Always being prepared to give a defense to anyone who may ask you. That's the actual 1 Peter 3:18 or 3:12. Be prepared. And so this is part of preparing. I don't want to walk back there and grab my big clunker Bible, so I'm trying to find this here. So, and there are other ways to do this, but again, we could do a whole day on this. But we're trying to just give you some specific tools for the honor shame. To me, the best illustration of that, because a lot of honor shame cultures are built around story and narrative and stuff like that. So let's tell a story, right? And the story of the prodigal son is that, and that is Luke. It's 11. It starts with chapter. Sorry, Luke 15, starting with verse 11. And I'm not going to read the story. I would assume that a lot of you are pretty familiar with the story. But as I was thinking about this, one of the things that struck me about this is that the son that left did not break any laws. Right? Or, the guilt to innocence, you've broken God's law and you need to be restored to that. The son, he did things that were terrible, but he didn't break any laws. He didn't, break this commandment or that commandment, really. He just treated his father like he was dirt, right? And so by taking his inheritance, that brought shame to his father. By living the way he lived, he brought shame to himself and continued to bring shame to his father because he was not carrying out, the desires of his father. But when he comes back, right, the father has been watching for him because he sees him when he's a long way off, right? And the father runs to him. And in first century Palestine, for a grown man to run was embarrassing. Right, that would be like me walking out there, me going down to Broadway and Second Avenue and taking my clothes off. That would be kind of an equivalent social embarrassment there, right? So the father shamed himself to get the son back to him, right? And then what did he do? Puts the ring on him, brings him back down, and have a great big party. That's what's supposed to happen with your father and your son. You're supposed to have big parties, right? And so the father can honor the son, right? And so the son's restored back to honor. So that's it. Right, and over half the world and 21st century America, this is where they live. It's like if they're self-aware, they know they brought shame. I wrote that backwards. Shame to honor. Sorry, it's not honor to shame, but they've got that. They've got that. They know that. And then so just read through that story with somebody, and just kind of comment on, notice how he's. He's not necessarily doing something wrong, but just how would his father feel, And then how would he feel about what he's done and stuff, And then how does the father respond to that? Well, that's what Jesus did for us, right?
How would we know if someone operates in that kind of mindset?
Well, if they're Asian or Middle Eastern, South American, pretty well nail on that. And if they're millennial, Gen Z, or then probably there's a big aspect to that, right? So hopefully, if you're in a relationship with them, do they recognize an outside authority, right? And then two, prayer, right? If you're praying for these people regularly, then hopefully God will be showing you, you know, that like, oh man, that's I really needed. There's an opening. What can I say in response to that? You know, and say, okay, prodigal son. Just talk to him about the prodigal son.
Don't you think in conversation you could probably discern whether they're experiencing guilt or shame?
Yeah. Yeah.
Guilt, then it's
What? And the distinction, so Angie said in conversation you wouldn't recognize if they're guilt or if they're feeling guilty or feeling ashamed. And correct me if I'm wrong, but guilty, you feel bad because of what you've done. In shame, you feel bad because of who you are. Isn't that pretty accurate?
Yeah, guilt is I've done something bad. Shame is I am something bad.
I am something bad, right, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I would recommend, you know, these three approaches, the guilt, innocence, shame, honor, fear, power. And I would, you know, if the Lord opens the door for you to have three different conversations and them knowing like, hey, man, I want to work through three different, you know, portions of Scripture with you sometime. Maybe you could do all three at the same setting and ask them which one resonates most and then dig deeper in that approach. And then on passages like the Luke 15 prodigal son is using, I like the Discovery Bible Study type of approach where you look up DBS, Discovery Bible Study technique and questions, man, the questions that they ask of like, what do you like about this passage? What's confusing about this passage? Like asking those questions that Discovery Bible has really made such a beautiful resource on and utilizing that through your discussion and letting them retell the story and whatnot. When there's a passage like the prodigal son parable.
And then also on that, would you add something at the end like the Romans 10:9-10, an assurance verse, a verse of this is how you ask Christ into your life?
Yeah, so Angie was saying after a prodigal son, would you say you need some explanation for how do you do that, like Romans 10:9-10, if you can, that you, you know, confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord, right? So a little... brief how to, yeah.
Back to the sales language.
Yeah.
The close,
yeah.
And with that approach, though, I understand how you let them understand the sinfulness and why. I guess I just can't get out of the.
Me too. Yeah. Yeah. I'm way too much away from that. Yeah. So the question Dina was saying, how do you show them the power of what they're forgiven from and stuff? And I don't mean this as I'm dunking on you or whatever, it's like that. But we're not showing them any of that. It's the Holy Spirit, right? You know, I'll send the Holy Spirit. He will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. So we've got to be dependent on the Holy Spirit to do that. And if He's not convicting them of it, then it doesn't matter. It's just words, right? Right. So, yeah. But I would say that, it's not so much, I mean, if I'm a Gen Zer, I don't believe there's any outside authority, I decide what's right and what's wrong, then I can't break a law by definition, right? So I'm not guilty of any law breaking. I don't need to be forgiven for anything. It's just that I'm just wake up on a Thursday morning, I'm just crappy, and so I'm broken. And then and for me, I mean, I'm just starting to understand this side of the gospel, right? And I'm 40 years in, you know, to this walk. And so there's things that you're just going to have to grow into. I think that may be a cop-out on my part to answer a question like that. But I think there's just a whole bunch of people that this will resonate with. I don't understand it. It's just not my worldview that I come from, right? I'm just trusting people that know that are saying that the other half of the world works that way, right? So, okay.
Is there an element in the shame-honor approach in dealing with, like, Gen Z or millennials where they're trying to
Great question. So she was saying that, if with Gen Zers or whatever, the without an outside authority, rephrasing it. So if I'm, can't I fix myself, right? And so there's a lot of spirituality, and I mean, there is. There's a lot of spirituality in the world today. There's maybe growing spiritual awareness and stuff like that. Short answer is no, you can't, right? I mean, we know that's the truth, but I think that's, again, that's something that God has to convict you of, because I'm still trying to fix myself, right? I mean, that's just inherent in us as humans. I think that's and trusting God is kind of like those are just like the biggies, at least for me, is like, you know, I just don't want to trust you, and I think I can do it myself, right? I just think I can do it myself. And so God, I think God's got to do that. I think one thing here is with the prodigal son is he did try to fix himself. He said, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go back to my father. I'm going to ask if I can be a servant. His servants have got it a lot better than I do. That'll fix it, right? So he came up with this plan in his mind to try to fix it, right? But the father's like, father didn't even hear. He's spouting out, hey, father, you know, I've sinned, blah, 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 blah. And the father's not even listening to all that, you know? He's saying, you know, Jesus does say that he said that to his father, but you can tell, at least I get the sense, that the father is like, he's like, you know, hey, get the calf, you know, get the ring, get the robe. He's busy with other stuff, trying to restore him to honor and not even listening to his plan, you know. So it's there, you know. So, here's your plan to fix it. Your plan ain't going to work, you know. Yeah, so
present the biblical perspective that we don't have it within ourselves to make this correction.
Yeah, so Angie's saying knowing some verses that or some of the verses that explicitly say that we don't have it within ourselves to do it. It's the Psalms. I think it's in the 40s or so of the Psalms where it says something to the effect of, you know, how can a man give a ransom for his life? Just the cost is way too high. Isaiah has got, you know, all of us like sheep has gone astray. You know, each of us has turned to his own way, but the Lord's laid on Christ the penalty for that. God's not so blind or deaf that he can't hear you, but your sins have made a separation between you and your God, so that he doesn't hear. You know, our righteous deeds are like filthy rags. That's the one I was trying to get to. What is that, Isaiah? Anybody know? Righteous deeds are filthy rags. Do a search on righteous deeds, filthy rags. I think you'll find it.
There's also times when God says that every thought of a man's heart is evil.
Heart's more deceitful than all else. That's Jeremiah 17, right? I think.
Reading in the prophets right now.
And then Romans, second half of Romans 1 and Romans 2 just talks about how, you were screwed up, you know. And God said, okay, I'll let you go off on your way. Right? So, or did you find it?
Yeah, Isaiah 64:6.
Our righteous deeds are like filthy rags, right? So, okay. All right, fear, power. Somebody told me about this. I was looking for a nice illustration, and a friend of mine suggested this. I'm just going to hold this up, and I wanted where I could read things, but he said somebody he was training on this came up with this idea. Take a sheet of paper, just half of it dark and half of it light, right? And just the idea of moving from darkness, which, remember, as our discussion is, that's where the evil is, right? You got to shut the door to keep the evil out when it gets dark, into light. You know, Jesus is the light of the world. That's a cliche, but that's still true, right? And so for the fear power, I've just got a couple of verses here and that kind of give us that idea. So John 1:4-5 is the one I've been saying, that in him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overpower it, right? That Jesus is the thing that has, he's the one who has power over our fears. Hebrews 2:14-15, I'm paraphrasing a little bit here, but Christ himself became flesh and blood that through death he might render powerless him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and might deliver those who through fear of death were subject to slavery all their lives, from darkness to light, right? So he could render powerless Satan and through his power free us from that slavery to death. Colossians 2:15 says, "He, Jesus, disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them on the cross." Right. So he put the things we're afraid of to open shame through the cross. I like that one because it specifically talks about the cross accomplishing it. Right. And then Colossians 1:13 says, "For he, Christ, delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son." I guess he, the Father, delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us from the kingdom, or to the kingdom of his beloved Son, right? And then just kind of as a summary, in the idea of fear and power, like there are things we don't have any control over that we're afraid of, but God has the power over those. Just with that in mind, just read Revelation 19. And it's like, holy smoke, it is the 5 minutes in the Battle of Midway where God wipes out the other kingdom. I don't know if you know the Battle of Midway, but World War II in the Pacific turned on 5 minutes when there was a break in the clouds and the U.S. attack planes saw the Japanese fleet and destroyed the Japanese fleet in 5 minutes, right? And then could not recover from that. Revelation 19 is the Battle of Midway in the spiritual realm. It's cool. So.
Another passage that I love is Hebrews 4:16, where, yeah, you know, Scripture teaches that God is holy and he's different, and there's rightful need to fear and to, like, even be ashamed of our sin in his presence, right?
But
it says, "Because of Christ's work, let us then with confidence draw near, not to the throne of judgment, but to the throne of grace, that we might find mercy in our time of need."
Yeah.
And that's just that. I just love that ability to be able to approach him.
Yeah.
And find mercy.
Yeah.
And it's a throne of grace. It's like there's distributing from this isn't the fear and judgment, but the grace and mercy.
Yeah. 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 Very cool. Okay. So we got some giveaways, right?
Yeah.
I'm going to leave that to you.
All right. Let's figure out how we're going to do this. And for those who are tuning in, we'll do this. We're going to give everybody here a copy of a book. And then the ones left over, they can come find us tomorrow, I guess. I can have the whatever we don't distribute today. And they can have what's left.
Yeah.
That's fair.
Yeah.
All right.
We're saying it's fair. It's gonna be.
So, man, I want to give Darius this one. It's Who Made God? And Answers to Over 100 Other Tough Questions of Faith. I think that'll really be, it's a great book. It's a fun book. It does answer a lot of questions. And then the others that we have here is More Than a Carpenter, which is an apologetics type approach to defending and understanding the gospel better. Master Plan of Evangelism, which my dad's professor in seminary was Robert Coleman. And this was, the master plan is, just a staple evangelism book. This particular copy, Billy Graham wrote the foreword. And then Will Metzger is a beautiful, reformed understanding of the gospel and the whole gospel, wholly, by grace, communicated truthfully and lovingly. Don't know what that feedback is.
Yeah,
but
not sure.
Anyway, that's a great book, Tell the Truth. And then Out of the Salt Shaker, Into the World, Evangelism as a Way of Life. And then J.I. Packer, Evangelism and the Sovereignty of God. Like, if God already knows, then what's the role of evangelism? If he's going to save, then what's our role and so forth? It's a small book, but a really powerful book. And The Case for Christ, similar to More Than a Carpenter. It's an apologetic book with Lee Strobel. The gospel comes with a house key. Rosaria Butterfield, a previous atheist who talks about her conversion to Christ and how people led her to faith and how she's leading others. It's a really neat read, powerful read. And then The 3D Gospel, Unpacking More the Ministry of Guilt, Shame, and Fear Cultures and How the Gospel Speaks into Those. And then Charles Spurgeon, might have heard of him. He wrote this book called The Soul Winner, and this was my Papa's favorite book, and it's why the last 15 years of my papa's life, he would talk to every single person in every single restaurant or coffee shop or grocery store that he came across. He would go table by table. So anyway, The Soul Winner by Spurgeon. What we'll do is we'll figure out a fun way of giving these out after we're off the live stream.
And there was one, it's not a book, but the Born to Reproduce, I guess I write that down. Mm-hmm. It's just a three-page printout. It's Dawson Trotman.
Okay.
Born to Reproduce, it's available through an audio talk or a PDF. You can just, like I said, it's like four pages of a PDF or half an hour of a talk or something like that.
Miss Angie has something. Yeah, flowing from everyday life rhythms to the conversation of the gospel. Yeah, a couple things before Tim, you wrap us up, and then I would love to read this prayer from Spurgeon.
Yes.
A couple thoughts that I just have written down is in regards to motivation of sharing the gospel with other people. I believe a key in understanding more how to express the gospel and have a concern for others is developing certain keystone habits that lend itself to where you can't help but share the gospel with others. Because we are constantly discipling and sharing the gospel with other people. If you are on a certain diet, you evangelize people in regards of that diet you're using. Or vitamins, or a supplement that you're taking, or a water bottle that has a cool filter. It's like we naturally talk about things that we're benefiting from. A good mechanic, a good deal on something online. Like we're constantly telling others about certain things that we enjoy and that have impacted us. And so we know how to do this. We evangelize really well. But how do we make Jesus and the gospel something that naturally flows to a conversation because it's something that we're excited about? And I would recommend keystone habits. One is developing a consistent daily time in Scripture every day. Like if you want to become someone who talks about Jesus a lot, read about Jesus a lot. Like spend time in Scripture. And then two is pray for greater faith in eternal judgment. Like pray for greater faith that there is a hell. Pray for greater faith of understanding here and now what eternal separation from God actually will be like. And that is a key, like if that happens, it's going to be natural to push people out of the way of that truck, to use Penn's illustration. But we just don't believe there's a truck at our core. Theologically we can, but practically we don't. And so praying for that faith, because if you are finding Jesus so interesting and delightful, and if you truly believe that there's a judgment coming upon man, the result then is going to be that you will more naturally and easily talk to people about Jesus. But if you're not finding him delightful, and if you don't believe that there's a true separation that's eternal, then it's easy to be apathetic and indifferent in how we talk to others about Jesus. But if you truly believe those things, it's when that water bottle system has totally like revolutionized the way that you drink water. It's when that workout program has changed your life. It's when you're personally experiencing something, you want other people to experience that. When you found a stock and it's making you a lot of money, it's like, hey, go buy this stock. Like you're experiencing the benefit of this and you realize it personally. Evangelism is simply that, just telling people about the change that you've experienced and inviting them into that change. And then, again, I think the Out of the Salt Shaker points this out to Angie's recommendation is it's inviting people inviting people to your meal week at your Access community, like for those Access communities that have that sort of just meal time once a week in their rhythm. It's just inviting them to a meal with your Christian friends. It's inviting them to church. It's setting up opportunities of just, just establishing a friendship and inviting them into your home, inviting them into your church, and then eventually inviting them to the cross, inviting them to Jesus. But
yeah, and just to interject in that, if we didn't want to spend a lot of time on it, you know, here, just different focus, but Jesus real clearly says that people will know that we are his disciples and he is the Messiah by the way we love each other. If they don't see us loving each other, mm-hmm. then they won't get a chance to see that, right? So Christian fellowship is a powerful tool for evangelism.
Yeah. Yeah. How would you like to wrap up, and then I can read the prayer?
For me, I just give yourself a takeaway, right? If like write down some names for a prayer list, even if names haven't come to mind, then be praying for names to come to mind. Take to heart those things that Jeremy said, and practice. Just pick one of these things and just practice. You know, read through the prodigal son as if you're talking to somebody that doesn't know about it, never heard it before, or practice going through the Roman road or these. And we particularly with the Roman road bridge, stuff like that, we've got, I mean, we can give you a lot more help with that. Anybody wants that, you know, so if you want to practice it, you know, role play it, things like that, we can definitely give some deeper instruction on that too. Mm-hmm. So prayer list going, and then just practice one or more of those, and that'd
yeah,
be the
awesome. Yeah,
get yourself a takeaway.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Tim, for your prep and your leadership, you and Angie both, and our equips, not just today, but all of them. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it.